Wilmington. My name is Dan Johnson, and I teach in the Department of Music, and as you might imagine, Scottish and Celtic music is one of my passions, and I'm very glad to share this with you all this afternoon. This event is co-sponsored by the Scottish Society of Wilmington, and to talk a little bit about that group, here's the president, Catherine Ford.
Hi, and I want to welcome you all. Thank you all for coming this afternoon. It's a wonderful crowd. We're really glad to have you. I see some familiar faces, but I see a lot of unfamiliar faces as well. So the Scottish Society would like to invite you to join us in the future for some of our other events. We have a table out in the foyer that has some of our information, and you can sign up for our email list. And we're delighted to be co-sponsoring with UNCW in this inaugural Bagpipe Festival, and as Dan said, we really do hope to have it be an annual event. So thank you and welcome, and glad to have you here. We do have a reception following, just briefly out in the main foyer. So look forward to seeing you all there. Thank you.
Before we begin, there are a couple of housekeeping announcements or items. Would you please now take a moment and silence your cell phone, beeper, pager, whatever other device you have attached to yourself, so we can focus on the presenter and the concert. Another piece of housekeeping is, as you exit the recital hall, there will be a display from the High Road Scottish and Irish shop. If you're interested in a souvenir or want to take a look at some bagpipe material, you're welcome to have a look at those items. They are for sale. And then next to that will be, as Catherine said, a reception following the program. Now, one more thing is, as you enter, you may have noticed these little orange ear protectors. These are foam, and if you'd like to use those, you're welcome to take a pair. Some people have more sensitive hearing than others. So. And now I'll speak for just a few words about our guest presenter. So Mr. Bill Caudill is the founder and the director of the Scottish Heritage Center, as well as being the pipe major at St. Andrews University in Warrenburg. He is a professional bagpiper and has played for decades in different venues. He teaches at the North American Academy of Piping in Valley Cruces as well. He's won many, many prizes, and as you can read in the bio, he's won the Best Carolina Piper Award for 28 years at Grandfather Mountain, and he is now the Vice President of the Eastern United States Pipe Band Association. It's the largest association of its kind, and he also, not only as a musician, but also is a historian, graduated from UNC Chapel Hill with a master's degree in folklore and history. So we're very glad to have him this afternoon present the Bagpipe Recital. Please welcome him to the stage.
Thanks for coming out this afternoon, folks. I wonder why I'm holding a bottle of Coke Zero here. That's because this is my go-to drink, and when I need to go, when I need to get everything going here. And I can sort of liken it back to a story about the great pipe major Donald McLeod, who came to New York City in 1967 and made some very famous recordings, which were made available about 15, 20 years ago for the first time. And it was said that when he was in that studio in New York City, that he drank a whole case of Coca-Colas. Maybe that's a good luck charm or something like that, but in case needed, it's here for me and for my little comfort, Jovia. Again, thanks for coming out. I'm looking forward to playing some tunes for you today. I'm going to start off with a set of 4-4 marches just to get the pipe going and settled. The first tune is called The Sands of Loch Bee, or also known as the Glasgow Police's March Past. It was composed by a island piper named Pipe Major John McDonald of South Uist. Gaelic speakers knew him as Shauna Ruid, Red John, who came from South Uist, but other people knew him as John McDonald, policeman, once he went to Glasgow and became Pipe Major of the Glasgow Police Pipe Band. Another island man that had a big influence on piping was Pipe Major Donald McLeod. Per the Coca-Cola, if he you a little bit more about that. So first a team by Shawnee Rua, and followed up by three little marchers from Point Major Don McLeod. Brigade, the 51st Highland Division was the brigade that covered the retreat to Dunkirk and St. Valerie. And the majority of that division was captured, including Pike Major Donald McLeod. He was a little guy from the island of Lewis, outside of Stornoway. And Donald McLeod happened to escape as he was being marched off to the prison camp, I think in Poland or someplace like that. And he escaped, was able to make his way back through the countryside and all, because anytime he was encountered, he always spoke back in Gaelic, which was his native tongue. And so all the Germans that encountered this guy thought he was some sort of East European or something, and just passed him on as a short guy. And he made his way back and was one of our great composers of pipe tunes. Again, the 51st Highland Division, followed by Flett from Flotta. And the last tune is probably a much older melody that he arranged and published called The Battle of Waterloo. I'd like to visit another of the famous wartime composers in our pipe music world. And it's a man called Pipe Major John McClellan of Dunoon. Some of you may have been to Dunoon there on the Cowell Peninsula. Ferry goes over to the Isle of Bute and all there. John McClellan Dunoon was really a Renaissance man, if you will. He served in the latter part of the 19th century in the British Army as a piper. He was in some of the Boer Wars, the South African Wars in the 1890s, and then also served in World War I as well. And one of the better known tunes that he composed was a tune called Lochinside, which was actually composed in the trenches during World War I. He also had a number of other tunes which commemorated some of the British military exploits during all of those wars, as well as perhaps even earlier wars. So I'd like to have a little tribute here to World War I. Gonna start off with a little slow Gaelic air, however, that was written by another Gaelic-speaking soldier in the Scottish Brigades that was in World War I in the trenches. And he wrote home a lovely poem, which became a very popular Gaelic song. It's called Anulavan, or The White Swan. And in the poem, the soldier Donald MacDonald Corunna talks about how he's missing his love as he's there in the muddy trenches and all, and he equates her to a white swan floating about on a lake. So lovely Gaelic song tune, and we go into some tunes that commemorate the late 19th and early 20th century exploit to the British Army. Pipe Major John McClellan Dunoon. long as I have, and you see, we never use a lyre. There isn't such a thing as a bagpipe lyre. Everything's sort of stored up here. Sometimes things come out that aren't exactly what you might have intended. But in any event, there was a John McClellan team that started that off called My Hometown, and another that followed, Lock Inside. And then we finished up with actually a team by another composer, certainly was inspired by pipe major John McClellan, and pipe major Angus MacDonald's retreat there, pipe major Angus MacDonald. So anyway, a little deviation from the teams there, but such things happen. How many of you knew the difference? Yeah, all right, good. All right, let's move on to some, maybe some dance music here. Who likes to dance? All right, yay. You see in your program some descriptions of some various types of dance music there. And one of the ones that is really indigenous to Scotland alone is the strathspey. And the strathspey was originally a form of fiddle music. And it would not have been played on the bagpipe until well into the 19th century, strictly fiddle music. But we have adapted that into our repertory now, and now it's very common to hear a piper play a march, a strathspey, and a reel, two different types of dance music. And that's sort of a meat and potatoes kind of serving of a variety of pipe music. But nonetheless, the strathspey is a very unique form of music. It's in 4/4 time for you musicians, but there are certain notes that are pulled out and stressed a little bit more than others to match with the movements that the dancer makes, particularly in, for example, like casting across the floor and things like that, in set dances and things like that, as well as the movements that a dancer might make in dances such as the Highland Fling. So the strathspey is a bit unique. I'd like to give you an example of some strathspeys and some reels which follow them, and you'll see the contrast in tempo between the two, as we said about here. And I'll have to try to give the names out of these after I get through, because we'll see what comes out.
Thank you.
probably didn't really know the differences between them, maybe necessarily there, but finished up in a transition from reels into a hornpipe, which brings me into the connections between the fiddle and the bagpipe. The Highland bagpipe here is an instrument that was elevated to a very high degree of patronage in the West Highlands. And the pipers were actually given small bits of estates in exchange for their services in the old days. The most famous of these being the McCrimmon family on the Isle of Skye, who were the patronized pipers of the clouds of Dagon. But nonetheless, there was other forms of music which began to evolve and began to become sort of introduced into the bagpipe repertoire as the fiddle was very popular at the same time. Particularly in the northeast of Scotland, in the area in Aberdeenshire and Spey River Valley, there was this type of music that evolved, i.e. the strathspey, such as you heard earlier. But there was also sort of an intermingling between these musical traditions and adapting of things from one to the other. That's how we got the strathspey and the reel tradition. Because in the old days, you would have heard pipers simply playing Gaelic song tunes, pibre, which is the classical music of the pipes, and maybe some jigs to get their fingers going. But there's today a lot of crossover, and there's a lot of lovely fiddle melodies which work quite well on the bagpipe. And I'd like to maybe visit particularly one composer. He's a man that's known as the Strathspey King because he composed over 600 of the things. he's really a bridge between the late 18th and early 19th century fiddle players and the 20th century, because we actually have recordings of this man. He was born in 1827, died, 1843, died in 1927, rather. His name was James Scott Skinner. And among his most famous composition is a tune called Hector the Hero. Hector MacDonald was a Gordon Highlander who had a meritorious service career. In the latter part of his career, he was accused of homosexuality, and as a result, he committed suicide. And obviously, this is something that we hear about in modern day society as well, and much less something that happened before the First World War. But there's a lovely fiddle melody which goes around the pipes. It's called Hector the Hero. I'm going to play that for you, and another of the marches composed by fiddle player James Scott Skinner. That's called Lord Huntley's Cave. It's certainly got a fiddle feel to it. As you'll hear, it happens to go quite well in the bagpipe scale. And then I'd like to follow that up with James Scott Skinner's most famous strathspey, written for his patron, the Laird of Drumblair. And we'll follow that up with some more reels, some round reels. So some fiddle music of James Scott Skinner and throughout Celtic fiddle world.
Thank you.
Lynn's Cave and Strasse, the way of the way up. We started off the reels with a tune called Tail Tottle, which is a really sort of bawdy song, both in Gaelic and in Scots as well, and finished up once again with a reprise of Tail Tottle again there, after some danceable tunes there. Right, one of the top signatures that I've not played yet is 6/8 marches. And 6/8 marches sort of have a little bit of a favorite status with pipers sometimes, because they're great melodies, they're great little kilt swingers. You like to see the kilt swing there. I don't know, I'm not the greatest kilt swinger. I'm more concerned with what's going on in the bagpipe than that. But in any event, I'm going to give you a couple of 6/8 marches, and we'll see what follows that. The first 6/8 march is composed by the gentleman that composed the tune I started the concert with, John McDonald, South Lewis. It's a tune called Miss Ishbel T. McDonald. It's one of my own favorite 6/8 marches. Had some good successes at contests with those. And I followed a tune that's very little heard, and a tune which won a prize back in 1981. It's called Lady Diana Spencer's Welcome from Royal Deeside. And it was composed for Diana Spencer's first official visit to Balmoral Castle after the royal wedding. And we'll see what happens after that.
Thank you.
called Tam Bean's Lump, composed by pipe major Donald Shaw Ramsey. And the second was called Gordon McRae's Favorite, and that's a more contemporary tune composed by a Canadian. I'd like to give you a presentation now of that sort of meat and potatoes of the piping world. A march, a strathspey, and a reel. The march that I'm going to give you this evening is one that is an absolute classic within our idiom. It's called the Highland Wedding. And it was composed by pipe major Angus Mackay, who was the first ever sovereign's piper. That is, he was piper as a young boy to Queen Victoria. And he was from the island of Rosyth, just off of Skye, between Skye and the mainland. And he was taken into that service because of his excellent reputation as an up-and-coming young player. Unfortunately, he was up-and-coming into more things, too, because once he got billeted at Balmoral Castle, he fell in love with a lot of the hired help around, and also fantasized that he was having a love affair with Queen Victoria as well. They think that he probably contracted syphilis due to his indiscretions, and as a result, he was going sort of mad, and they trucked him off to a mental hospital down in Dumfries, where he died trying to escape in 1859. But nonetheless, before he died, he was one of the early scientific notation people for bagpipe music. He put the classical music into staff notation, made a major collection in which we still are influenced by today. He's the composer of the Highland Wedding, which is one of our earliest march tunes. He simply took a simple folk tune called Stumpy and sort of worked it up and added embellishments and all to make it into really something special, and it's an absolute classic within our idiom. I'm going to follow that with the strathspey, the Caledonian Society of London. And then I'm going to follow that up with a reel called the Sheep Wife. Now, don't let your mind go too crazy on that one. Only men in the Highlands. It's actually an old Gaelic mouth music tune they used to know as Bodoroshan, but now we know it as the Sheep Wife. So a march, a strathspey and reel in the classic style here.
Thank you.
in the bagpipe repertoire called Pibro. And it's described a little in your program. It's centered on one theme, or sometimes called the Erlau, that's the opening theme, and then there are a series of variations, and the variations become more and more complicated as the tune goes along, and then the tune finishes with a return to the Erlau, to that theme one more time, playing a bit of that theme. Pibroch has a complicated and in-depth history, which we don't have time for this afternoon, but you're welcome to Google that. And to help you sort of listen to the piece of music, I'm going to be projecting the sheet music. It is not exactly what you might be familiar with if you're a classical musician, but it does give you a little sort of guide as we listen to this piece of music. The ornaments and the are a little more complicated than written here, but you'll get the general idea, and I think it'll help us listen to this piece of music. This is the Lament for a Merry Flower.
Let me give you just a couple of notes before I start the tune here. For an audience such as this, I always like to introduce people to the classical music of our instrument. But to a lot of people that hear it, they say it all sounds the same. A lot of it's very esoteric and probably be appreciated by a piper maybe with a bit of knowledge. But this one, I think if you know a little bit about the story behind it, you can hear the pathos and the emotions coming through in the music. Mari Mian Alasarua, Mary McLeod was a bardess to the McLeods of Dunvegan. And if I'm not mistaken, it was the 16th chief who had ascended to that position. And the McLeods had always been the greatest patrons of the arts in the Highlands. They had the best bards, the best harpers, the best pipers, and the crones. And it seemed as though this 16th chief did not have the same appreciation for the arts as the previous chiefs had. And so there were some words that were written by Mari Mian that evidently were not kosher approved, were not the nicest things to say about this new chieftain. So, in a roundabout way, she was accused of being a witch, which was never proven, but she was banished from Skye and forced to live away in other locations. She eventually was able to come back to her home, but she always had that cloud over her head. And so when she was buried, after her death, she was buried face down with the ultimate sort of insult, final insult to someone. And the Macrimmon composer of this tune, I think, not only conveys the sadness of the event, obviously the passing of this great bardess, but also provides some protest. How dare you? Which I think you'll hear coming across in the music. A Lament for Mary McLeod.
Thank you.
I'd like to finish with just one little note. I'd like to thank Dan Johnson for having me down to do this. I just turned 55 just a few weeks ago, and almost 8 years ago, I had a pretty serious thing happen to me. I was playing a contest, and I ruptured C3 through C7 in my cervical spine. And I lost between Memorial Day weekend and Labor Day weekend, when I finally was able to get in for surgery, I lost the feeling in these fingers. And I still haven't really completely gotten back all of the feeling in that left index finger. Now, what I gave you tonight was maybe a good sampling of piping, but it's certainly not world-class piping as it is today. You got a glimpse back into the 1980s and some of the teams that I grew up with and admired and all there. The standard of piping now has really just become incredible. It's one of the reasons that I'm not only sort of aged out a little bit, but fingered out a little bit too. Because these 20-somethings that are coming along, God, it's like they got 20 fingers and they move twice as fast as mine do. But in any event, this gave me an opportunity. I've not done anything serious like this really since the occurrence of that event. And so Dan sort of gave me a motivation here. I made a New Year's resolution. I was going to play my bagpipe every day after New Year's Day. And I've done that. Some interest in piping here in Wilmington once again. Again, this is becoming so mainstream. When I grew up outside of the Charlotte area, I just happened to be lucky in the 70s to have at least found a reasonably competent player that my folks could take me for lessons to. And you know, I fortunately was able to take it on my own a lot because there wasn't a lot of great piping in the South at that time. And I listened to a lot of recordings and CDs and pre-CDs, cassette tapes in my car in high school. And I tried to emulate the sounds that I heard and the people that I heard. And so I'm sort of a melding of a lot of different resources and ways of going about things now. But you've got resources now. I mean, now we can study with anybody in the world almost, you know, via the internet. And I've done a good deal of teaching in the area, and I'm happy to do that. And I would really like to see something really take off here in the Wilmington area. And I'd like to pledge to you my backing and help in trying to make that happen if that's in the cards here. let me finish off with one little tune, if you don't mind, here. It's called the Banjo Breakdown. And I'm just lucky I didn't break down today, because it's stressful. Thinking through all the tunes, when you've been working through this years and years, you sort of have a lot of tunes going through your head. Sometimes things don't come out the way they are intended. I'm fortunate that my youngest son, is piping. And he's done very, very well with his playing. He's been playing about 5 years now. Going on 5 years, and he moved himself up through the ranks. He's currently playing, he was ranked third last year in the whole Eastern U.S. in the amateur grade 2. They have 5-4-3-2. That's next to the top of the amateur grades. And last year he was submitting his first hornpipe and jig. I played some hornpipes and some jigs for him. He was playing his first hornpipe and jig, and he says, "Dad, I got this tune of all, and I want to submit." I says, "What do you mean you got a tune? You got all sorts of tunes somewhere. Get rid of that crap." And you know, give me. And he said, "No, Dad, I really like this tune. I'd like to submit it." And I said, "Okay, you're taking your own life in your own hands here. You know, what are you going to name it?" And he said, and the thing that really got my heart was my dad passed away in 2020, and he said he wrote it for him. And, you know, we couldn't title it Planting Tomatoes or Gathering Corn or anything like that. And he says, "Well, I'm going to tie it to something that sort of sounds traditional-like, maybe called Sowing the Fields." I thought, that's really pretty good. And so he composed this tune, and I said, "Well, off you go to make this recording and send it off for judging and all there." And a little scutter won his first contest and got comments about